We'll just start. We'll just wait for the maximum number of participants to reach. So, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all the attendees gathered here. First of all, my heartiest welcome to Mr. Shilaram Varma for our extension to be here. And thank you, Mrs. Ganapriya, for being the moderator for today's webinar. And thank you, Mr. Inverma Jain, sir, for being the whole guidance for this webinar. So before jumping on to this whole session, I would like to just give a small introduction or a brief history of KFCRI. So Kovai's Foundation Conflict Resolution International is one of the fast growing institutions globally. So we function, our program is in major three folds. One is we function as an institution, other is we function as an accreditation body, the other is a think tank. As an institution, we have our own rules for all the area practice such as arbitration, mediation, negotiation, and even for the tribunal secretary. As an accreditation body, we train and disseminate various professionals from various diversified fields, and we help in the substantial development in the same professional fields. As a think tank, KFCRI is conducting so many webinars, so many events in its noble objective of promoting the ADR practice. So before I'm handing over to Mr. Inverma Jain, sir, to give the introductory remarks about our special lead panelist, I just want to give up a brief of housekeeping rules. I would request all the participants, please refrain from using the chat box. And you can post all your questions now and then in the Q&A box, which is right next to the chat box. So please, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shanmugadev. Good afternoon to everyone. Today, we are happy to welcome Mrs. Sushilram Varma. She's a very interesting personality based out of our national capital. And interestingly, she's the founder and chief consultant of an organization called the Indian Lawyer and Allied Services, which has its operations in many parts of India. It's a pan-India law firm wherein she's dealing with litigation, she's dealing with arbitration, and she's also a reputed negotiator. To further add on, she's also the president of the Child Foundation, a non-governmental organization which is very active in safeguarding the rights of child. She is also a member of the very reputed Supreme Court Bar Association as well as the Delhi High Court Bar Association. Today we all are going to hear a very interesting topic, that is the domain name dispute resolution, which is considered to be an emerging trend when it comes to all these sector-specific arbitration. And KFCRI sectors, one of the sector-specific arbitration webinar, we are very happy to invite Mrs. Sushilram Varma. And for another 45 to 50 minutes, we are going to hear about the very interesting topic, DNDR. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you to the management and team of KFCI for having organized this webinar. I agree that the topic is extremely important in today's day and age, with the pandemic taking up, literally engulfing everybody's lives. So I'm very happy to be here, and I think we can begin.
Thank you, ma'am. So
welcome to today's session.
Yeah, Dana Prima, please go ahead.
Thank you, Dave. Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's session. I'd like to extend a warm welcome to today's speaker, Mrs. Sushilram Varma. It's a pleasure to have you here, ma'am. I'll be moderating this domain name dispute arbitration webinar. I'm sure that the webinar will take valuable knowledge on domain name dispute arbitration. The session will give you knowledge on what is domain name, What are the legal rules and policies? Domain name dispute and how it is resolved. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. Can we start the session, ma'am?
Thank you, Ganapriya. Yes, of course, I'm ready.
What is the meaning of domain name and how it is significant to today's world of business?
Well, Ganapriya, to put it very simply, I would say domain name is the online identity of a person, a company, or any business entity that wants itself known in the global business or in the global scenario. It's an online address that enables people to reach you, and it's a way of making other people aware of your business or your organization. And I would say that a domain name is an extremely important aspect of any virtual business. And in today's day and age of the pandemic crisis, it has become even more important than ever before.
Ma'am, can you emphasize on the relevance and importance of domain names?
Yes. In the past, domain names were things that people were using as an alternative means of doing business, but not anymore. Today, the world has shifted from the physical world to a virtual world. So I would say that the relevance of domain, which is an identity virtually, is extremely important, and it can't even be defined regarding the importance, because with this domain name, today you can reach anyone in any corner of the earth. I might be doing work in India, but I have clients from New Zealand to the US. So I'm able to reach out to a very wide variety of people and clients only because I have a domain name, which gives me a recognition and gives my firm a recognition across the globe.
Valuable information on what is domain name. And you have pointed out that it is an online identity. So can you brief on how the domain names are registered?
Well, the process is very simple. There is a body which is called an registrar. Now, internationally, the most important registrar is a body called ICANN, which is an acronym for International Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. ICANN has formulated an international level domain policy, which is known as Uniform Domain Name Dispute Resolution Policy, or better known as UDRP. So this is probably the primary organization across the globe that is very well known for registration of domain names. So any person who is interested in getting a particular domain name registered can approach ICANN if they so choose to. Other than ICANN, there are bodies in every country that plays a similar role to ICANN and has a similar dispute resolution process. Now, taking the example of India, I would say that in India, under the Department of Telecommunications and Telecommunications, we have an organization called National Internet Exchange of India. This, in short, is known as NICSI. Now, NICSI has set up an IN registry, which registers the domain names of people, entities, companies, etc. in India. And they have formulated a policy for domain registration, for domain regulation, and dispute management pertaining to domains. And this policy is called the IN Dispute Resolution Policy. So this forms the bedrock of deciding disputes between parties, and we will get into it a little later. Another very important thing that I forgot to mention is domain names are given on a first name, first come serve, first basis, it's not as if, even if you've got a business running for say 20 years and you're using a particular name, if you have, and somebody else approaches the registrar for registration of a similar name, the domain name will be given to the person who has first approached the registrar and not to the one who has been existing, say, for the last 20 years. This is probably the reason why domain disputes arise.
Thank you, ma'am. What are the types of domain name that are currently prevalent?
Well, currently there are domain names which are called second level domain names. That is, if you have a particular name, say www.theindianlawyer.in, the second level domain name will be the Indian Lawyer. And after that, you also have the primary level domain name, which is called top level domain name, which is, for instance, .com, .org, .in. So this is the primary one. Then you also have country-specific domain names, such as IN, which stands for India, or AU, which would stand for Australia. Additionally, there are certain domain names which are customized for organizations or the government, like we have NIC, or we have similar names like GOV, which is customized for particular registrants. Then there are also certain domain names like gov.in, NIC.in, which is restricted for use only by the government of India. So as you can see, there are several types of domain names that are available and can be registered.
Thank you, ma'am. Very informative. So when we register a domain name, the registrations will be governed by policies and rules. Can you throw light on the policies, ma'am?
Yes. ICANN has a policy which is called the UNDRP, which I introduced a little earlier. That policy will regulate the domain registration, and in case there is a dispute, the domain disputes. Now in India, we have something called INDR, and that regulates the disputes in India. So it is a similar body like ICANN, but it's called DICSI. And they have their own policies which will regulate disputes.
Ma'am, can you discuss about ICANN? Can you brief on the Indian policy, ma'am?
Yes, the Indian policy is called Indian Dispute Resolution Policy. In short, it's called INDRP, and it governs all domain names, their registrations, their regulations, and most importantly, in case there's a dispute, the dispute redressal process in India.
Now we have discussed about the ICANN and INDRP policy. Can you bring out the differences between the INDRP and UDRP policy, ma'am?
Yes. The In Dispute Resolution Policy, which is INDRP, restricts domain dispute resolution to only one arbitrator, whereas the international policy, which is UDRP, allows a complainant to have more than one arbitrator to decide the dispute. In under the Indian Dispute Resolution Policy, you can go for resolution of one issue at a time, whereas under the international, you can take up several issues in one particular policy. Additionally, as per the Indian rules, you can have one arbitrator to conduct the proceedings, and in the international, you can request for more than one arbitrator depending on what is the amount that is in dispute. And as per the Indian INDRP rules, the arbitration laws of India will apply. So although the policy will be, although the rules will be as per the INDRP, but the law will be as per the Arbitration and Conciliation Act. So this is probably some of the most important aspects. Another important aspect is that under ICANN, they encourage video conferencing. And in India, you can have physical appearances. But of course, now with the corona period, there is no question of physical appearances. And probably the most important thing is that in the Indian context, an arbitrator can award costs, whereas internationally, they can only limit the dispute resolution to cancellation of a domain name or transfer of the domain name. So probably this is the most vital aspect.
It's very important and its differences. And ma'am, who decides on who shall be a domain name registrar? And is there any website that lists out the global domain names?
Yes. Globally, it would be ICANN that gives permissions to organizations to become registrars. It obviously depends on certain eligibility criteria regarding their network, regarding their operations, regarding their financial standing. In India, it is decided by NICSI. They decide who will be deemed to be a registrar of domain names.
Can you say about the websites that list out the global domains?
Well, there are several websites that register or that list out global domains. One of them, I think, currently the Registration Data Access Protocol or the RDAP is supposed to be the best repository of domain names across the world.
Is it necessary that a person who registers for a domain name must be the owner of the registered trademark? If yes, please specify, and if no, please explain how this can be done.
Well, Ganapriya, it is not necessary that someone who has a registered trademark can only apply for a domain name. There are many times when a company or a business entity applies for a trademark and is not granted a trademark, but that is not to say that you cannot apply for a domain name. You can definitely apply for a domain name whether you have a registered trademark or not.
Ma'am, is there any relation between domain name and trademark?
I would say that both of them serve a similar purpose. Domain name serves as an online trademark, so to say. It serves as an identity, or it creates an identity for a individual, entity, or organization that is extremely important in the online world, and especially in the online business world. So domain names are, I would say, extremely important for three reasons. The first is that they promote the business. The second is they establish credibility of the website or the business. And third, they allow customers to easily approach you.
That's a lot of information on trademark and its relation with the domain name. Is it correct that a trademark is country specific?
Yes, trademarks are country specific. And when one applies, one can apply in a particular country. But with some changes in the ICANN policy, one can also apply for a trademark in several countries on the basis of one application. That is now allowed.
If a trademark is not registered, what right does a person have on a domain name?
Well, if a trademark is not registered, then the registrant of the domain name will have to show that he has been using it prior to the existing registrant. That is the first thing he'll have to show. He'll also have to show that he has created a brand of that particular domain, and as such he is entitled to the domain as compared to the new registrant who has taken his name. And he will also have to show that he has spent a lot of money in developing the business and the brand associated with the domain name.
So far, we have talked about domain name, the registrar, trademark, the relations, and what is deemed to be a domain name dispute and who can decide on a domain name dispute.
A domain name dispute would be a dispute pertaining to protection of one's domain. Generally, a domain name dispute would arise if somebody tries to take your domain name or tries to take a similar domain name and misuse your particular brand or your name. Or secondly, it tries to divert the traffic from your particular website to the existing domain name that has been registered. And thirdly, it could also be something pertaining to where you have taken a domain name just for nuisance value, just to act as a competitor, just to harm the business of another. Now, one thing I wanted to mention when you were talking about trademark, see, even if a trademark is not registered, you will still have your remedy under common law because of prior usage. And if you are able to satisfy a court that you have achieved a particular brand or a recognition or a name because of your particular name, which has not been trademarked, you can establish that you are entitled to protection for that particular mark.
Ma'am, so far we have talked about the domain names and the types of misuse, how the domain names are misused. So when a complainant has raised a complaint, the other person, the wrongdoer, he will definitely take a defense. So what is the defense that a cyber squatter can take?
Well, actually, before we get into that, I would like to say that a domain name is misused if the domain name taken by the second person, that is the registrant, who has not been using it, is taken for causing confusion in the minds of customers regarding the product of the first registrant or the first user, and it is also used to divert the traffic or his business or harm his reputation. So generally, there are cyber squatting is when a particular registrant registers a domain name with the intention of profiteering by the said name. He may not take it to use it for himself. He may just take it and sit and wait for the original registrant to approach him and then try and take that particular name. For instance, suppose it's kfci.in. There might be a cyber squatter who would have bought kfci.com, and he would wait for you to approach him so that you can buy kfci.com from him at a much higher price and enable him to make some profit. Or he might even sell it to a third party who is a competitor for KFCI in order to create confusion in the mind of users or members of KFCI and thereby divert the business and the traffic that KFCI can expect. Now, cyber squatting there are four types of cyber squatting. One would be cyber squatting, which I have just explained to you. The second would be a cyber parasite. A cyber parasite is someone, a registrant, who takes a domain name which is similar to an existing well-known name. For instance, if there is a name called Nike.com and somebody applies for Nike with a double E.com, then he would be a cyber parasite because he would want to sell his products on the name and the basis of the first brand, which is very famous and very well known. So this would be a cyber parasite. apart over and above that, there is something called cyber twins. In cyber twins, it is a possibility that two domains would have a similar name, but they would not want to hurt each other or harm each other. It is just that because they have used an acronym, they accidentally have the same domain name. And lastly would be what is known as domain name hijacking, which is purchase of a domain name in bad faith with the intention of only controlling the domain name of another for whatever ulterior motives and not possibly profiteering himself, but harming the business of the other. Okay.
Ma'am, can you brief us on the defenses that is taken by the cyber squatter, like the extraterritorial and the fair use, what you have mentioned earlier? Can you brief us on that a little more?
Ma'am? I repeat your question. What are you saying?
The defense available to a cyber squatter.
Well, a cyber squatter would be the defenses he would have would be that I have been using it prior to the complainant, that he has been using it in fair, in good faith and not in bad faith, and that he is not using or harming the domain of an existing domain or brand name of an existing domain. These are the particular pleas that he can have. He can also try and show that he has a business with that particular domain name much prior to what the complainant had.
Thank you, ma'am. And we have some interesting information on the slides you have given to us. Would you like to brief on these case laws, these interesting case laws, ma'am?
Yes, the case laws will speak for itself. For instance, in Starbucks. Actually, I think the case laws will speak for itself. Why don't you just slide it? Because we have mentioned what each case law is about. So you could, the viewer could see it and understand. We have put it in short as to what happened in each case. Now, before we go there, I wanted to just be clear on one thing, which I felt was important because we are on domain name dispute resolution. Now, domain name dispute resolution can be by way of court or it can be by way of arbitration. Now, organizations like ICANN, NICSI, are promoting resolution of domain disputes through arbitration, which happens within their organization and with their rules in place. But you also have the option of approaching a court and asking for the relief that you're seeking from these adjudicating panels. The reason I would like to point this out is, while the arbitrators who are trying to resolve the disputes in these particular forums have powers to resolve the dispute, their powers are limited only to the extent of either cancelling the domain name which is taken in bad faith, or directing the registrant to give his domain name to the complainant. So it is limited only to that area. But if you go to court, you can ask for the damages that your business may have suffered due to a cyber squatter. You could also ask for loss of goodwill. You could also ask for a permanent injunction restricting the second domain name registrant from misusing your domain name. And additionally, you could also ask for the costs that you have incurred in trying to fight this litigation. So the scope of the court is definitely larger than that of the arbitration. The only minus point is that as far as the courts are concerned, they are much more expensive and they take a very long time. So most people are a little hesitant about approaching the court and prefer these forums which are cheap compared to courts, and which also decide the dispute in a period of 15 days to maybe a maximum of 45 days. So that is the plus point.
Thank you, ma'am. Can you say about how the domain name hygiene is being dealt with during this pandemic?
The domain
name? And what you for the dispute service pro?
Can you repeat what you're asking?
How is the domain name hygiene is being dealt during this pandemic? And what are the new approaches formulated by the dispute service provider?
The new approach, I would say, is that registrars are now responsible, have got a larger role and more duties when they are registering. They have to ensure that there is security in when they're giving the domain name to a particular registrant. They have to ensure that there is a certain reliability so that people can go back to them if there is any issue about the particular domain name. And they also have to adhere to certain technical standards, which have to be which have to be state of the art so that they can control to a certain extent certain aspects of misuse of domain names. Now, Ganapriya, you wanted me to actually discuss the case laws. I think since time permits, I think I will take you through the case laws. The first one is, can you take them back to the slide, please, where the Starbucks. Now, the first one that we have mentioned is Starbucks versus Mohan Raj. In this, the trademark of the complainant in this case was that Starbucks was their particular brand. The respondents took a domain name which was called starbucks.co.in, and he had taken that name which was identical and which was taken with the intention of causing confusion in the minds of the public. This matter went up for arbitration, and it was held that the complainant had bona fide rights and a trademark on the word Starbucks. And the respondent was asked to transfer starbucks.co.in to the complainant. Now coming to the second one, which is pertaining to Morgan Stanley, which is a very important bank, versus Bharat Jain. This was also decided by an arbitrator. In this, morganstanley.co.in was the disputed domain name. Morgan Stanley had a mark, which was a trademark called just Morgan Stanley, and they contended that the addition of .co.in, which was given to the respondent, would be damaging and would cause confusion in the mind of their customers and clients. And as such, they had challenged the particular domain name that was confusingly similar to their own name. And ultimately, the arbitrator decided in their favor, and the mark was directed to be transferred to the complainant. That is the bank Morgan Stanley. The third one, which we have mentioned, is very interesting regarding Google Inc. Now, a complaint was made against the registration of a domain name called not Google, but Googly.in. And it was alleged that the respondent had knowingly taken that identical domain name so that he could create confusion in the minds of users of Google. Obviously, Google approached an arbitrator for cancellation of this particular domain name, as it was identical and confusing. And they were successful, and the arbitrator allowed Google.com to take this particular name. So the name was transferred to Google.com. So these are the three important cases that we have mentioned in our slide. And now, is there any further questions?
Ma'am, can we take questions from the viewers, ma'am?
Certainly, certainly.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Mr. Venkateshan Ramakrishnan, he has asked, in real life scenario, what kind of dispute arises?
Well, in real life, like I said, the most common dispute would definitely be cyber squatting. It happens all the time. There's a famous brand, like in that McDonald's case. McDonald's is a very famous brand. A man called McDonald took a domain name called McDonald.com. There was some variation. And he fought the case. And ultimately, surprisingly, he actually won that case because he claimed that the domain he had taken was as per his name and it was not taken in bad faith. But in most cases, it is taken in bad faith. It is taken only with the intention that one day the user of the registered trademark or the brand will approach the cyber squatter and buy the same brand at maybe 20 times the cost or maybe even 100 times the cost because it has become a recognized brand.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another one question he has asked. If a domain name dispute has arisen, for resolving the dispute, who has an authority to arbitrate?
Who has an authority to?
To appoint the arbitrator.
Well, the complainant will approach either the organizations like ICANN or NICSI if it's in India. So when the complainant approaches, the complainant has the right to appoint the arbitrators. He decides how many arbitrators he wants. And in most cases, he even has to pay if he is doing it, right? In most cases, he even has to pay for the arbitration fees. Ganapriya, there's one thing I wanted people to know that in these organizations like ICANN and NICSI, they have also introduced a way of settling matters through mediation. So if two parties are actually having a dispute which is being decided, which has to be decided by ICANN or by NICSI, and the arbitrators feel that there is a possibility of settling the dispute, then they encourage mediation and one can sit across the table and decide how to resolve the matter.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another one question regarding the resale of domain name. He has asked whether the resale is illegal. If it is illegal, is there any provision which proves that?
Well, if it is, see, in some cases it's legal. In some cases it's not illegal. It's not legal. Now, in the case of McDonald, that gentleman said, McDonald is my name. So how can you say I can't take a domain name McDonald, right? So, but I would say it is illegal when you are taking it with the intention of being a cyber squatter. That is, you've taken it and you're waiting and watching to see whether the person who has the brand will approach you or whether some of the competitors will approach you or maybe someone who is making counterfeit or second quality goods with a similar name will approach you. So in such a case, it is definitely illegal.
Okay, ma'am. One person, Dineshwar Gaur, he has asked,
yes,
what are the privacy issues involved in this IPR related domain name disputes?
Well, the privacy issues that we are looking at is basically that you, whatever domain name you take should not breach or should not harm an existing domain name or existing, more than a domain name, I would say an existing brand name. So that is where the issues will come. That it should not be in bad faith and it should not harm a brand or a particular, the reputation of a domain name holder.
And there's a question from Rajesh Hazra. He has asked, domain name dispute can only be resolved through arbitration or court also.
Yes, domain name disputes can be resolved through arbitration, through court. The process of arbitration is much faster. And if you do it through the organizations like ICANN or NICSI, it will also work out to be much more reasonable in terms of costs of arbitration.
Thank you, ma'am. A question from, can a dispute regarding domain name be directly taken to an arbitral tribunal without issuance of a notice?
No, in civil law, if you want to take any action against any party who you feel has taken away your rights, you definitely have to put them on notice. So whether it's an arbitration, whether it's a court matter, it doesn't matter. You have to first send out a notice and see whether how the other side responds, because many a times and many matters are settled without really fighting out a litigation. Of late, there is a law called the Commercial Courts Act, in which the law says it has become mandatory that before you approach the court, you have to sit in a mediation process and you have to try and resolve your dispute. It is only if you have failed in the mediation process that you can go to court.
Google.com case, how yes. Arbitration happened without there being no such argument between parties. I think he is trying to ask, like, when the parties are not getting into an argument, something, how the dispute has been settled.
Additionally to Ganapriya, I'll just try to put that question. In Google versus Googly case, how arbitration happened without there being any agreement between the parties.
Okay. Now, when you go for registration, I've understood the question. When you go for registration and you get the domain name registered through the registrar, there is a contract which is entered into between the registrar and the registrant, that is the domain holder. So that particular contract talks about third party rights and talks about dispute resolution and etc. And as such, a third party can be sued for using a similar name or for trying to misuse a existing domain name which has become famous. So in this case also the same thing must have happened. Although the person holding googly.com may not have been a party to the contract, but because the contract, but when he took the domain name, he agreed to be bound by the terms and conditions of the contract between the registrar where he got the googly.com and himself pertaining to third parties.
So thank you so much, ma'am.
Ganapriya,
I think we have asked many number of questions and it almost concurs with everything. So I just want to take an immense pleasure to summarize a bit like what our lead speaker has brought out here. It was really wonderful and it was an informative session that ma'am brought out the importance of domain name disputes, especially in the current scenario where every blink there is a growth in the technology and everyone has their own trademarks and everyone is trying to, every corporates or any entity if we take, they are almost in the verge of taking domain names. And I think definitely there is a boom in the sector of domain name disputes. And thank you, ma'am. And thank you for bringing out like how the process of arbitration in a domain name disputes is being settled either through any sort of ADR mechanisms or it can be any hybrid process of mechanisms and how the parties are reaching to an agreement and how all the process of domain name is booming out. So thank you so much, ma'am. It was really an informative session.
There is someone who has asked us to share the slides. I would just like to add here that after this particular program, one of my team will upload this on YouTube on a program called Legal Fundamentals. That is the Indian Lawyer Legal Fundamentals. We have uploaded several videos to enable people to understand different aspects of the law. So they can access it by going to YouTube, TIL Legal Speak. Legal Fundamentals. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. In line with that, we will also make sure that all the participants here, you're getting the PPTs either with the mail or we'll try to share among our close social contacts what we have. So thank you for this wonderful slide given, ma'am. And I would request Mr. Indrajit sir to give a few concluding remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Shanmugam. Ma'am, it was a really enlightening session about the dominion dispute resolution. The way presentation was articulated, it was really wonderful, so that even I am as a commercial arbitrator or a construction arbitrator, it is a lot, many things I could understand. I had a good understanding of this dominion dispute resolution and how it works. To more particularly, the three case laws, what has been highlighted, gives a nation understanding, because when the dominion was actually started in India, there were two common top-level domains, that is the country level and the generic level top-level domains. Those days, I think hardly six or seven were the generic level top-level domains. And when it comes to the creation of the initial period of NICSI, we found that the scope of practitioners, and particularly arbitration practitioners in this dominion dispute, was very, very, very limited. But now, considering, I think, more than 4 to 5, very interesting thing I learned from it is that the international top-level domain, that is .Bharat, what I saw in the presentation, the last one, it is a new thing for practitioners, arbitration practitioners like me. I think this would be a good takeaway for us to seriously consider that this is one sector wherein arbitrators and arbitration councils have a great opportunity. And for law students, they will have a good opportunity, career opportunity for them to explore. I think these are some comments I wanted to share looking into the presentation. And I'm very happy and thankful that you're kind enough to share this entire presentation through your YouTube platform, so that it is not only confined to the participants wherein we reached, it is also good for participants and really interested people who happen to be in a different arena and diversified professionals. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure. And I look forward to meeting you all again. Thank you.
So, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you,
Gana Prema, for this wonderful session. And once again, I extend my heartiest thanks to the lead speaker, Ms. Sushila Rangamma, for your wonderful presentation and for a good show. And for the benefit of all the students and the participants here, I just want to give a nice update that KFCRA, along with Satyabhama School of Law, is conducting a webinar jointly in collaboration on coming 15th of this month. So it is more going to be in mixed personality kind of presentations. We are invited so much speakers all around the globe from all parts of the directions, you can say. So the speakers involve, like, I take very immense pleasure to declare the speakers list, such as Dr. Christopher Tu from Hong Kong, and Mr. Ramesh Alvarat sir from Singapore, Mr. Muthupandi Ganeshan sir from London, and from Mr. Ben Girata from London, and Dr. Kapit Tukal and Dr. Rekha Rangachari from New York. They are all going to enlighten us on coming 15th of this month. So this webinar is going to be more of a joint collaboration along with the Satyabhama School of Law. The invitation and other thing will be definitely reached via all the social contacts we have. And all the unanswered questions and the feedback will definitely be answered to you You can even mail to us if you want some questions to be answered. We'll approach our lead speaker, Mr. Shilaram Verma, to answer that, and we'll get back to you. So thank you so much. Thank you all for your kind attention and listening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.